What's up, Greg? This is Dusty. Just boxing conspiracies, and I don't know, man. Just been so stoked on the higher side chats. I've been doing nothing but listening to you guys when I'm driving pizzas at night. The Hattie Bob material is just absolutely mind-blowing in the way that it fits into the electric universe, in the way that the electric universe fits into Hollow Earth. It all just, it's wild, man. Keep doing what you're doing. Thanks a lot. Make another donation soon. You fucking rule, man.
The planet's puppet masters almost surely have a plan. There's clearly maybe something there beyond the realm of man. And until you've thoroughly tested every last close trusted view, I find the more you think you know, the less you really do.
That's true, Dr. Zayas.
Where would we be without THC? Cause we know they're lying to us, just don't know.
Holy hell, Higher Side Chatters, drinking a little drink, smoking a little smoke, altering to keep from faltering here in sunny San Diego, I'm Greg Carlwood. And people, we know the world is a weird place. We have cryptid encounters from nearly every corner of the globe, occult rituals that conjure up contact, thousands who report alien abductions, and entheogenic experiences that are as strange as the day is long. And as much as I love these topics, sadly, many high strangeness researchers have a one-track mind. You'll find a lot of Bigfoot hunters have no interest in spiritual entities, and many alien abductee researchers have no interest in things like psychedelics. And of course, the list goes on. But lucky for us, today we have a guy who's very willing to wade through the crossroads and intersections of these fields, and has approached the study in a new book through commonalities that might not be immediately apparent: food and drink. His name is Joshua Cutchin, and the book is called A Trojan Feast, The Food and Drink Offerings of Aliens, Faeries, and Sasquatch. He has a master's degree in journalism and musicology, currently working for the University of Georgia's music department, and got his strange research start studying trickster elements of classical music and Russian folklore. How could I not like the guy? Josh, my man, welcome to THC. How the hell are you?
Hey, I'm doing great. And slight addendum, I actually broke free from the chains of the system, and I am doing my own thing now, teaching music and writing books. So I'm happy.
Love
I'm
real it, happy. Man. Congratulations.
Yeah. it's one of those things where you look back on it and you say, I should have done this about 5 years ago. So anyway, yeah, well, you got to trust yourself.
Amen, man. And yeah, dude, I am pumped for this. Last time I had Nick Redfern here, it was months ago, and we were talking about inner earth beings and crypto-terrestrials and psychedelics, and he said, oh, you got to read this Trojan Feast book. And it took me a while, but the premise was so interesting, I definitely did not forget about it, and I loved it. It's right up my alley. And I guess to get us started, what was it that brought you to pull on this particularly pretty undisturbed thread?
Well, first of all, a big thank you to Nick. He's been a real champion of this, and it's just bizarre to me to be in a place where he's talking about something that I've written, because I've been a fan of his for so long. I have been a fan of these sort of topics for quite a while. And I'd always sort of had a keen interest in the similarities between fairy folklore and, in particular, modern alien abduction folklore. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the sort of passport to Magonia, Jacques Vallée line of thinking. And one of the things that always really stood out to me was the food taboo, this idea that especially in Celtic folklore, if you were to take food from one of the fairies, you would be trapped in fairyland forever and actually have to remain there with them.
Right.
So, you know, I saw some vague parallels with this in certain abduction cases where people were offered food and drink. And I'm like, well, that's sort of interesting. But, you know, obviously abductees don't stay with aliens forever, or else we'd never hear the stories. But my light bulb moment, my true light bulb moment, was when I was reading J. Robert Alley's Rain Coast Sasquatch, which is a great book. It's about Sasquatch sightings all along the coast of Alaska and northern Washington. And he mentions I believe it's a Tsimshian Native American belief that if you were to take food from Sasquatch, their version of the Sasquatch, you would be trapped with Sasquatch forever. And I sat back and I said, wait a minute, this is weird, because, you know, if it was anywhere on the, you know, Eurasian continent, you could sort of say, well, maybe it's related to the, you know, the typical belief of fairy folklore, but this is separated by this entire ocean. Now, I'm as much of a fan of diffusionist thinking as anybody else, but it still gave me pause and made me think maybe there's something here. So I sort of tugged on that thread, and it was this really rich, rewarding subject, which I was really, really interested in. I sat back and I said to myself, I would like to read this book, but no one has written this book, and I don't think anyone's going to write this book. So I just decided to do it myself, which, you know, that's a pretty big moment in your life to make the decision to be associated with these things. Mm-hmm. but I did it, and it's been one of the best decisions I've made.
Yeah, man, I love it. And the food taboo, that is something that I guess I've never heard it put in that term. But yeah, it is something that comes up in a lot of these stories that I had read before, but of course, way more in your book. And you mentioned that it was a kind of a Celtic thing, and it does span other cultures. But in the book, you say it's also Nordic and comes up in Jewish traditions. Can you tell us about those threads?
It comes up in a ton of different folklore. In fact, I'm pretty sure that anyone who has watched films, any fantasy films of any type, has run into these sort of things. Yeah. You know, this idea that, you know, whatever you do, don't eat the food while you're there. Specifically in Nordic traditions, in the Finnish Kalevala, the hero Väinämöinen is actually given a tankard of beer while he's in the underworld. And even though it would have quenched his thirst, he refused to drink it. But you see this literally all over the world. As I mentioned, there are some Native American beliefs to this idea that if you take food from the other, you will be trapped with the other forever. In Mesopotamia, there was this hero named Adapa who refused food from the god Anu. In Japanese culture, Izanami died in childbirth and ate food in the afterlife and never returned to the living. In certain island cultures in the South Pacific, they feel that if you can go visit a deceased loved one, but if you eat food while you're there, you will be trapped forever. And a lot of people, a lot of folklorists will say that this all is an evolution of the myth of Persephone, who was the daughter of Demeter, who was tricked into the underworld by Hades. And when Hades was due to release her, he actually tricked her by giving her a pomegranate seed. And once she consumed it, she was trapped in underworld for eternity. And every, you know, spring she would come up just for a little while to rejoin her mother. But to me, the idea that this is all the outgrowth of this one very specific Greek myth sort of falls apart when you look at how widespread it is in terms of being, again, off that Eurasian continent. So that's sort of where the basis for the book starts. And then it looks at how that basic ideas sort of reflected in folklore that we have with all sorts of, you know, unexplained phenomena.
Yeah. Another example I liked is even as far north as Alaska, you talked about a tribe who have a legend that if you see something they call the woodsman, or their word for that, it invites people to share in its feast. And if you do, you again become one of its people and are trapped in its world.
Yeah. And that's another interesting little parallel with that, is that the food that the woodsman gives you actually, it looks like dried salmon, but it's actually tree bark in disguise. And this is, another direct parallel to that Celtic fairy folklore, where they would give you food, but it was actually cloaked in glamour. And in reality, it was leaves and twigs and worms and such. So it's just this one-to-one comparison that I just find absolutely fascinating.
Yeah, man, I do love that thread too. And another thing that's interesting that's in your book is just how strong fairy beliefs are in Iceland. You mentioned that it's not uncommon for construction or road work to purposely avoid or work around areas that fairies are thought to inhabit, which sounds so foreign to an American, where we don't even give a shit about the animals we know are living right there in the areas we want to take over. But I mean, that's amazing.
Yeah, it's almost as if the zeitgeist of Iceland, from what I understand, has sort of a better safe than sorry mentality. You will run into tons of anecdotal stories about construction workers, you know, who don't heed the warnings that, oh, this is a fairy boulder, this boulder is home to fairies, and who will go to start up their construction equipment and the equipment will fail, or, you know, certain stretches of highway where it's said that a fairy tree was knocked down and there are wrecks along that highway. So, yeah, there's actually a very vocal group of people who are like, you better not mess with this. And I think that the more, for lack of a better term, secular folks in Iceland sort of cope with this idea by saying, well, it's preserving heritage. But there are some people who really believe, they'll, you know, will go out to a field and they'll be like, look at this giant slab of granite. That's a fairy school, which, you know, me personally, I'm pretty agnostic on a lot of these things. Where I fall at the end of the day is saying that there are too many similarities to discount, and that I believe that something is going on. But, you know, my interest is really in these shared comparisons. But as far as, you know, oh, fairies are real, or aliens are real, or Sasquatch is real, you know, I don't really feel comfortable saying any of that. But apparently some Icelanders are comfortable saying that. So.
Yeah, I've heard you put it that you think that the ET hypothesis is too tidy of an explanation for an untidy phenomenon. And I think that's a great line, man. I really do agree.
Well, thanks. You know, it's not a controversial thing to say, but I say that as somebody who came into it, like a lot of us do, thinking that that must be the answer. And, you know, the more you get into the sort of reality bending aspects of this, the less possible that really seems from a standpoint that we can understand. You know, perhaps there are intelligences from other planets visiting Earth who have the ability to generate synchronicities, who have the ability to transport you into a dreamlike realm. That's entirely possible. I'm not writing that off. It just seems less likely to me, from what we know of the way that biology and evolution tend to work, that that's what's happening. So, you know, again, this sort of agnosticism, but I feel like I've had a lot of people say, if they're coming to, you know, collect biological material, you'd think that they'd have gotten enough by now.
Right.
If they're, you know, drilling into people's skulls to collect DNA, you'd think that they'd have methods as non-invasive as our methods of collecting DNA, which are often, you know, a mouth swab. So yeah, it seems to me that there's more theater involved than a lot of people want to imagine.
Yeah, man. I think it was Michael Mott who really got me thinking that the Greys could actually be creatures that we share the planet with who just don't tell us where they're from. They just say they're from outer space. And then he made the connection to fairy lore, which obviously you get into a lot in the book. And now more than ever, I wonder if these two phenomenon aren't part of the same thing, which definitely seems to be something you entertain too.
Yeah, I mean, and it's bizarre because it really does extend into the Sasquatch thing as well. I mean, let's just take a look at a couple of things. You've got short beings, often accompanied by bright lights, often accompanied by a buzzing sound, found along lonely roads at night, very interested in our reproduction. You know, fairies would sleep with people and they would swap out babies for changelings of their own.
Mm-hmm.
Often the shorter ones are supervised by a taller entity in fairy folklore, which is the same thing that you run into in abduction accounts. And something that a lot of people don't want to talk about, which I would love for there to be a flesh and blood Sasquatch. But at the same time, you know, Sasquatch looks an awful lot like the Celtic Woodwose, who was a fairy of its own right.
Mm.
Sasquatch is accused in some areas of braiding horses' manes, which sounds laughable until you consider the fact that that's, again, a trait of a lot of fairy folklore. And people are starting to report more now odd lights seen in Sasquatch heavy areas. So you've got all this, and then you've also got this food taboo, too. So I think that what I am really fond of saying at this point is that I'm not sure if these are all the same thing, if they're different faces of the same thing, or if they are different things using similar methods. But at the very least, the Venn diagrams touch somewhere. somewhere there's some overlap that I think is really important. And I think that if we could pay a little bit more attention to that, we might actually make some headway instead of, again, like we were talking about before the show, instead of doing another book on Roswell.
Right. Yeah, man, you don't hear about Sasquatch abduction cases very often, but that was interesting. You do have one in the book. What's up with that?
Well, you know, Sasquatch abduction cases are, I think the line that I use in the book is hard to find, like hard to come by, and then even harder to find legitimate ones. Yeah. Or ones that sound legitimate. Yeah, a lot of, I mean, there's plenty of Native American folklore about Sasquatch abducting ladies for possible reproductive purposes. Again, the reproductive angle that we just mentioned. But hands down, the most famous testimony in modern lore is the story of Albert Ostman, who claimed that in the early, I believe it was around the 1930s, he was working as a prospector in British Columbia, and while he was sleeping, felt himself lifted from the ground in his sleeping bag. And after a short time, he was plopped into this valley, this shallow valley, where he saw this family of Sasquatch who were apparently just keeping him, I don't know, just as a pet or something. It's what he speculated later. But it was four Sasquatch. He thought they were maybe father, mother, son, and daughter. And he stayed there, according to him. He actually swore an affidavit to this effect in 1957. He claimed that he stayed there with them for several days and then was given some sweet roots to eat that had this sort of satisfying taste. Unlike fairy folklore, he ate the food and he didn't stay because he actually ended up tricking the father, who was standing guard, into eating his can of snuff, which it then, you know, obviously didn't like and proceeded to flush down its throat with boiling hot coffee. So that apparently, according to Ostman, that created enough of a distraction for him to escape. You know, it's a story that in a lot of ways strains credulity, but at the same time, you know, it's interesting to see some of these interesting little parallels, because a lot of the things that people receive in some of these cases or in fairy folklore were sweet foods.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and sticking with Sasquatch for a little bit, I guess when it comes to Sasquatch encounters, where do we see food come into play the most? Sometimes with hunters, right?
Yeah, you know, it's sometimes with hunters or prospector, general outdoorsy types, perhaps because most of the body of Sasquatch abduction tends to feature women being taken, usually for salacious purposes. We have a lot of stories like that. Coming out of Native American folklore, there was a young lady by the name of Seraphine Long who claimed that when she was 17 years old was snatched up by a Sasquatch who rubbed tree gum over her eyes before taking her to its lair. This is interesting to me because, among other things, it was said that in order to see the fairies, you'd have to have, you know, an ointment rubbed on your eye, or, you know, a very common thing in abduction narratives is that that people will be rubbed down with ointment as well. So anyway, I digress. Mm-hmm. And apparently she claimed that she lived with this Sasquatch and gave birth to its child. I think she stayed there about a year. And while she was there, she was given roots, fish, and meat to eat. We have another story from, I believe, the Himalayas of a Buddhist lady who was taken and who was also given some, you know, raw meat to eat during her stay with the Yeti, actually, as it was. So it's interesting because in terms of folklore, Sasquatch lines up very closely with the idea of the food taboo and the idea of, you know, the fairy folk. But when you actually look at these cases in reality, a lot of the things that are given in Sasquatch cases sort of tend to have less in common with fairy folklore. For example, in fairy lore and in modern alien abductions, people rarely, if ever, I could literally probably count on one hand, not counting a couple of contactees, but I could literally count on one hand the number of people who claim to be given meat of some sort in fairy or alien abductions, whereas that's almost always the case in Sasquatch lore. So that sort of makes me believe, well, maybe perhaps there's a biological flesh and blood reality to Sasquatch that you don't see with fairy lore and or, you know, alien, for lack of a better term, lore. But it's interesting how they are sort of there's a similarity there in terms of the folklore, but not in terms of the actual practice.
Yeah, you know, Sasquatch, I don't talk about it very much in the show because I guess the idea of a missing link ape really isn't super interesting or really surprising to me, but I do hear more stories about them being involved with portals of some kind. It makes me think maybe they're walkers between the worlds or maybe something akin to skinwalkers or something in that realm.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting because I feel like Sasquatch in a lot of ways is people's gateway drug into this into these sort of topics, because it's on the face of it, it's a very easy thing to buy into. Well, you know, there's a lot of land in the Pacific Northwest and it's possible that there could be, you know, a big monkey running around. So I think that it serves as a way to get people into these sort of topics. At the same time, once you start digging at it a little bit, you find, well, it's just like with the alien, the extraterrestrial hypothesis. It's a tidy explanation for an untidy phenomena, the idea that Bigfoot is biological, because there are plenty of reports of, you know, Sasquatch tracks stopping dead in the middle of an untouched snowy field. You know, I still think that there is something to be said for the fact that we've never had a dead Sasquatch show up anywhere that we know of. Yes. And of course, people will say, oh, the government's keeping it under wraps. Or they will say, well, you know, people don't run across dead black bears in the forest that often, and there must be more black bears than there are Sasquatch. But at the same time, people have at some point run across bear carcasses.
Right, we only need one.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So I think that there's something a little bit stranger going on there. Sometimes I lean towards the idea that perhaps there is a biological and a more mystical component acting in tandem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I remember why I said hunters, because there seems to be a slight collection of stories where a hunter will shoot something and then chase after it and its kill will be gone. And I guess in one case I found particularly creepy, he came up on his kill and it had been kind of buried.
Right. You know, in terms of Sasquatch giving people food, with hunters that doesn't happen very often, but in terms of Sasquatch taking food from people, yeah, it happens quite often, allegedly. Yeah, it's interesting because if you look at this idea of receiving food from unknown entities. I don't think you can talk about that without at least examining to a certain degree unknown entities taking food, you know, from the opposite end. You know, a lot of people used to leave food out for fairies. That was a very common thing. But yeah, it's not at all uncommon to hear about hunters who will see an animal go down and go towards it, and the animal's not there, nor is there a blood trail. So it seems like, well, something must have come along and picked it up. Mm-hmm. One of the interesting stories that's in the book is of some guys who shot a black bear in the Pacific Northwest and actually dug a shallow pit to hide it because they were going to, you know, go off and get their truck to be able to haul it out. And they actually put the black bear carcass into the pit and covered it with branches and leaves so that it wasn't visible. And they come back and it's completely gone. And, you know, I think it would take probably several wolves in tandem to get a bear carcass out of a pit. So again, it's not, you know, you can't say that that's Bigfoot unless somebody saw Bigfoot doing it, but it's very suggestive of that. As long as we're entertaining these sort of fringier ideas about Bigfoot, I've started to wonder sometimes if there aren't two separate phenomena going on where there's Bigfoot in an area, but there's also forest poltergeist because you look at a lot of the stuff that is attributed to Bigfoot. Like, for example, you go on the BFRO website, Bigfoot Field Researchers Organization, and you look at the Class B reports where it's like, well, we, you know, things that seem to indicate Sasquatch, but nobody ever saw a Sasquatch. And the things that they see are stones being thrown, unexplained voices and calls, mm-hmm. Phantom smells, obviously footprints. You know, a lot of these really, the feeling of being watched, a lot of those sound like if they were in a house, we just talk it up to poltergeist phenomena. So sometimes I wonder if there's not a Bigfoot, and, you know, Bigfoot tends to inhabit poltergeisty areas.
Yeah, man, you're so right. I never really considered that, but those are the same kind of things people report in a house or a haunted hotel or something. But I wanted to backtrack a little bit to the first story that you opened the book with. It's a brief story of Astri Alsdatter. I love this one, but can you tell us what happened to her and why you chose that as the opener?
Yeah, it was a wonderful, wonderfully creepy little story about a young girl who was in Norway in June of 1720, was herding cows for her employer, when she actually ran across her employer in the wilderness. And he appeared to her, and he was accompanied by this strange sort of music coming down from the mountains. And he said, "Can you hear that?" And she goes, "Yeah, I can hear it too." And he goes, "Well, come on along, follow me." And, you know, this girl's working for this guy on his farm. So she's like, "Sure." And as soon as she gets, you know, a little bit away from the herd, it turns out that four other guys appear, and they're all dressed in these red shirts and black trousers with blue stockings and round black caps. And, her employer changes into one of these guys too. So she's got five of these identical guys staring at her. And they actually grab her and throw her into this door inside the mountain, this large metallic door that swings shut. And of course, she's terrified. And it wasn't long before somebody who said that he was a priest came along to her and said, "You know, this is great. It's going to be fine. It's wonderful. Here, have a drink." And she refuses. So a little bit later, a woman who appeared to be the priest's wife, which is sort of, you know, a little bit contradictory, the priest's wife, you know, unless they're Anglican, which in Norway in 1720, they weren't. Anyway, I digress. But the priest's wife shows up with this food and says, "Come on, girl, eat this. And before she actually ends up being released, she's asked to eat or drink something eight times during the course of this time. You know, at one point, they show her this giant feast, and they say, "Eat here, as you can have anything you want, as long as you refuse to go back home. Forget your old life." You know, one of them apparently took on the form of her aunt and her mother and offered her, you know, "Oh, we'll wed you to a fine man and we'll give you riches as long as you eat this." And they never got her to eat it. So 5 days later, even though she felt that it had only been about 12 hours, she reappeared at her employer's farm. And did not recall eating anything, and told this story to a newspaper in Norway. So again, you know, we got this newspaper from 1720. Who knows how "quote unquote" real it is? But at the same time, that the folklore is startling. I mean, she was returned after refusing to eat this food, and obviously there was some sort of motivation for them to offer her eight times something to eat. This story is a little bit of an outlier in the sense that it's longer. You know, she was apparently away for 5 days. Most of the time that you run into stories of people encountering fairies or people encountering aliens, they're there for, you know, even though they have this compressed sense of time, which is common to both fairy and alien lore, a lot of times it's not even that long. It's like, oh, I thought it was 30 minutes and it's been 6 hours. Okay, well, 6 hours is kind of long, but it's not so long that you would starve or thirst to death.
Yeah.
So why are these other intelligences offering people something to eat or drink? It implies that there must be a reason that they want to do that. Mm-hmm. So I think that, you know, I think that that's another reason that, because at some point when writing this book, I was like, am I writing a book that's the equivalent of, you know, all things breathe? Ooh. Everybody, you know, everybody who sees an alien or fairy or a Sasquatch says they have eyes. Look at the commonality. And, you know, I sort of was able to talk myself off the ledge on that by saying, you know, this is weird. It's weird that people have these very brief encounters and are offered something to eat.
Mm-hmm. It is weird. And the reason I love that one so much is I just really enjoy stories of hidden underground civilizations or beings living inside something like a mountain. Because it has that crypto-terrestrial angle to it, the idea that we are cohabitators on the planet with something else very intelligent. And I guess this is fairly common. I mean, it comes up throughout history in a lot of these stories, doesn't it? Especially mountains.
Oh, Lord, yeah. I mean, if you want to parse this all out, most things that we talk about that are Fortean or paranormal, for lack of a better term, come from the underground. You know, ghosts are buried. People have suggested that Sasquatch lives in caves. People maintain to this day that they're underground alien bases. Fairy mounds in the UK are supposedly where the fairies live. You know, lake monsters dive underwater. There's always this sense of submersion, of being subterranean. That's a very common theme. I don't necessarily think that's – I mean, yes, it's another thing in favor of there being a commonality, but I don't think that's necessarily proof that you know, lake monsters are connected to Sasquatch too. But, you know, maybe. But it's interesting. It's almost – I'm sure that a psychologist would have something to say about the idea of the subconscious, so this being like a manifestation or expression of that on some level. But yeah, there's we've had this fascination with something beneath our feet, and every now and then something happens that gives us pause and makes us say, maybe there's something to that.
Mm-hmm. Well, like you said, with the commonality of everything breathes or has eyes in the past, of course, the idea is that, well, it's got to live somewhere. And it wasn't until aliens really that the idea of living off planet came into the picture. So I guess it's not that strange in the past to think that they'd live on the only place that we knew things could possibly live.
Yeah. For the most part, you know, you run into a few exceptions to that rule. I'm not taking the piss here. I'm not giving you a hard time. Just being a devil's advocate. But, you know, you do look at ideas of like Mount Olympus or, you know, Shambhala or something, Shangri-La, or, you know, also, you know, the idea of medieval France, the idea of Magonia, the kingdom in the clouds. But you're right. For the most part, there's this idea of descending. Again, all the way back to Greek myth, this idea that Hades is underground. Yeah, we have this fascination with the subterranean realm.
And of course, you know, there's multidimensional angles too that people bring up. But I mean, obviously encounters happen all over the map, but the legends obviously do seem strong in the north. We talked about Alaska and Iceland. Scandinavia is big. And I even hear... I've heard the case made, I think from Michael Mott again, the case made that the legends of Santa Claus came from these beings who had come out in the harshest of the climates in the north and bring supplies down to the people. And of course, there's no way to know, but that's probably my favorite explanation of what Santa Claus could be. And it could relate to what we're talking about, supplies. What would supplies be other than maybe food?
Yeah, I mean, you run into a lot of, you know, what in my mind immediately jumps to with an idea like that. By the way, Michael's definitely the guy to talk about subterranean subterranean entities. I think that's what his book is about. But my mind immediately jumps to these stories. Have you heard of Friendship Island?
No.
Oh, you got to do a show on Friendship Island, man. It's great story. It's this idea that there's this. I'm probably going to get something wrong. So if anybody, just go ahead and yell at the podcast if you want to. This idea that there's this this island, almost like the Lost Island off the coast of Argentina, where this race of Nordic aliens live. And every like 7 years or something, they'll come on over to the mainland and they'll trade goods with people and they'll always pay in gold. And it's this great story that it's one of those things that the more you dig into it, has this really big branching rabbit hole that you go down. But yeah, it's interesting. I did collect a bunch of stories about people, about entities buying food or trading food. But again, that was one of those things where there's just so much data to work with, because it seems like this is a niche subject. But man, once you start picking at it a little bit, it just all comes to the surface, and there's you have to pick and choose. But yeah, I love looking at the pagan or occult origins of, you know, the secular Christmas trappings of Father Christmas and whatnot. I was actually thinking about that earlier today.
Right on, man. Yeah, I'm going to have to look up Friendship Island for sure. And in terms of your book, it seems like there's at least more than a handful of stories of people who are invited into a house or a restaurant of some kind and have a whole experience there, leave, and then look back behind them and the place is completely gone.
Yeah, there was a great story that I really like. I believe it was in somewhere on the West Coast of this family who were, you know, they're on a road late at night and they couldn't find any place to eat and they needed to eat. And they pull into this odd shaped diner. They said it looked like, you know, this Art Deco diner with this domed roof and everything. And they go in and the wait staff is really friendly, but kind of odd, and they eat their food and they end up leaving. And once they get in the car to go leave, their car won't start. So they have to kind of push the car out onto the roadway and then it starts. And once they get to their destination, which is just, I don't know, an hour or so down the road, they start talking to people about where they ate. And everybody goes, there's no restaurant there. And everybody goes, what are you talking about? And sure enough, they go back and there's absolutely nothing there. And they had some missing time as well. And, you know, so again, like, why pose as a diner? You know, you have to think that's another thing that you have, the conclusion that I think that if you're really interested in these subjects, you have to resign yourself to, is that whatever we're dealing with is 9 times out of 10 completely in control of the situation.
Yeah.
So it seems like every action is deliberate in some sense. So in that case, why try to trick these people into coming into this diner and eating this food?
It is. Another story that I really liked in that same vein was one in the book about a guy, I think his name was Jacob Jacobson, and his story. Do you recall that one?
Yeah, Jacob Jacobson was a Scandinavian fellow in Sweden. And in the late 1700s, he was returning from an errand with his father when he saw this long road that just had appeared out of nowhere. And being a curious young man, he decided to, you know, set down that road. And he ended up at this large settlement that he wasn't familiar with. And there didn't seem to be anybody there until he entered one of these buildings and he saw these crowds of little people who were running back and forth and preparing this feast. And there was a taller, attractive woman who was sort of supervising them all. And she says, you know, oh, how wonderful you've come here. Would you please like to stay and eat with us? And obviously, probably remembering the, you know, the fairy folklore, Jacobson says, oh, you know, God, please get me back to mom and dad. And like that, he ends up back at where the road had begun, although the road was gone. And 4 days had passed, even though it had seemed it was still the same afternoon. So it's a great little story. I really do like that one because, you know, again, the idea of this taller supervising entity is right out of modern abduction lore, too.
Right. Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to point out, is that it's another crossover for the Greys, because there are stories of, oh, I came across 6 Greys and a tall white being, you know, with blue eyes and blonde hair. It's weird, but that's another thing that makes you think possibly these phenomena are connected.
Yeah, that's one of those details that people don't talk about in terms of connecting the two. But I love it because there's another story that's a favorite of mine about a woman who had eaten a fairy plum and was trapped with the fairies. And they were also supervised by a taller entity. And this woman who had been trapped with the fairies said, you know, don't eat their food. It's all a sham, which again is that idea of this glamour cloaking the food. But also, you know, they're not Christians. They're star worshipers, which to anybody who's interested in ufology is just like this giant red flag.
Yeah, man. And not to get too weird, but that also makes me think about World War II. And, you know, there's a lot of occult, esoteric aspects to the Nazi party. And they were really into things like the Hollow Earth. And then they're into the Aryan race, which is, of course, blonde hair and blue eyes. I don't know. I find that realm interesting, but you can start sounding pretty racist when you go in that territory.
Well, you know, just because you're interested in those similarities, I don't think really means that. I mean, yeah, you can stumble into saying something that you'd regret, but right. You know, I mean, there is this weird Nazi occult connection that is a rich vein to research, because there's so many connections there and so many of the strange beliefs that they had and strange things that they were trying to track down for Hitler. It's just, yeah, that's speaking of rabbit holes, that's a deep one.
It's just a weird commonality. But on a show called The Higher Side Chats, I do love that you stress the idea that this food and drink connection could be psychedelic in nature. Can you talk to us about what brought you to that idea?
Well, you know, it's interesting because as somebody who is a relative neophyte to these sort of things, I felt that there was nothing really of a much deeper meaning to the psychedelic experience. You know, it seems like the pop culture answer that a lot of us just buy hook, line, and sinker is that these are completely subjective, internalized events created by the brain. But the more you look into it, especially with the use of entheogens, which are, you know, supposedly God-releasing substances in different cultures around the world, the more you find that people are obtaining information that they shouldn't know when in these states. People sometimes have shared hallucinations under certain substances, which to me implies some sort of objective component. If you look at a lot of these substances as they're used in shamanic practice, specifically thinking about psilocybin mushrooms or, you know, the in vogue subject ayahuasca, a lot of them have creation legends that have them being portrayed as gifts from the gods. So if you want to sort of use this idea loosely, I mean, this is the ultimate example of what we're talking about in this book. It's food from the gods that we can examine. And it's interesting that there are a lot of similarities between the entheogenic experience and, you know, experiences of alien encounters, experience of fairy encounters. I mentioned the buzzing earlier. People tend to be taken apart and put back together sometimes in these trips, which is, again, a complete reflection of the abduction experience. Graham Hancock actually, during one of his ayahuasca sessions, claimed to have seen an entity offer him food. And he said, oh, no, I remember Persephone. And he opened his eyes. I spoke with a guy who was having an ayahuasca session in Peru, who said that while he was out there sitting in the jungle, he saw this stairway appear to the side that led into the earth, to this giant wooden door. Mm. And he says he was Irish. So he says about that time a leprechaun popped up. He's like, I'm Irish. This is what my culture is. I just identified it as a leprechaun, and said, hey, how about you come and have a drink with us? And he's like, well, sure. So he gets up to go, and the supervising shaman just storms out of the hut and comes and grabs him and drags him back into the hut as if he knew what was going on. So, yeah, there are these interesting little parallels there. And it's tempting to say, well, these entities are giving people entheogens, which I try to go to links in the book to say, look, that's not the case, because A, this doesn't happen in every encounter. You know, I would consider it a motif of the abduction experience, but it's a minor motif. And B, you know, in that case, if these entities are giving you a hallucinogen, how do they first approach you without you having a hallucinogen already in your system?
Right.
You know, to sort of lower the veil so that you can communicate with them. Well, they've already got to approach you somehow. So, you know, I sort of come to some different conclusions personally about the role that this could serve in almost terms of a symbolic capacity. But there's a lot of symbolism between entheogens and between the sort of liquids that people consume. One of my favorite examples comes from the work of the late Carla Turner, who was an abduction researcher, who studied at length Ted Rice, who was the subject of her book Masquerade of Angels. And he was taken at one point by some gray aliens who gave him a green liquid and told him to drink it. And he refused, and the entity said, no, if you don't drink it, you're not going to go home, which is a nice little inversion of the food taboo. And he ends up drinking it, gets nauseous, vomits, sees his soul rather coming out of his body, and at the same time has this immense feeling of love. And if you look at that, it maps almost directly onto the ayahuasca experience. The ayahuasca is a purgative. It makes you vomit. You have these intense feelings of love. People report out-of-body experiences. It's quite startling how these sort of tend to overlap on one another.
Right. That story is really interesting because a lot of psychonauts and psychedelic users talk about these being natural tools for insight. But yet our culture, of course, is quarantining them, and they'll lock you in a cage for life if you start experimenting. And then also with the alien abduction phenomenon or contactee experiences, they're often taught things like, you know, look at what you're doing to the planet. You're destroying the planet. Basically better ways to live. And you could equate almost this to the same thing. They're like saying, look, you got these tools here. You need to stop ignoring them. And here, let me force you to take it and have the experience.
Yeah, I mean it's one of those things that I don't approach these subjects from a new age angle, but at the same time you cannot deny that there is oftentimes, if people are to be believed, a very positive introspective component. And I think that that's worth looking into, and how it sort of dovetails with a lot of these psychedelic experiences of self-improvement.
Agreed. And none of this is an exact science, but you mentioned Graham Hancock, and I was lucky enough to spend some time with him in Armenia last year. And of course, like you said, he's very experienced with ayahuasca and its main ingredient, DMT, which apparently our brain produces while we sleep. And we were talking about it. He's of the opinion that alien encounters could be just when the brain dumps DMT on us unexpectedly. Or maybe that's why some people have lifelong experiences, because they have a chronic chemical imbalance. Not to say that what they're experiencing isn't real, but they could just have the door open a little more often than the rest of us. And I think that's a compelling argument.
Oh, I mean, I absolutely think that that's a great idea, a great theory. And you know, people get up in arms about it, especially people who are entrenched in the extraterrestrial hypothesis. But you know, it's not, again, like you said, it's not saying that there isn't some sort of objective component. I think to the contrary, there are a lot of times when people have, again, obtained knowledge or have some sort of truth revealed to them that really sort of goes against it being an entirely subjective experience. Are there probably trips that are just goofy ass trips? Yeah, there probably are. I mean, right. It's, you look at what the African Aboriginal lore holds, that there are big dreams and little dreams. You know, sometimes a dream is just a dream, but sometimes you have these big dreams that actually have some sort of meaning and actually give you some sort of information from outside of yourself. So I think that probably these experiences are very much the same way.
Mm-hmm. And we talk about ayahuasca, of course, like you said, it's very in vogue. It is a bit of a fad right now, but you also talk about soma. Talk to us about that.
Yeah. Soma is a giant question mark. No one really knows exactly what it was. It was a beverage from the Vedic tradition. Most people agree that it was an entheogen. But in terms of the exact components of it, no one has really been able to determine that. Some people have proposed that it's actually it was actually a dilution of the Amanita muscaria, but I've had some people say that that doesn't seem like a very good candidate, because apparently fly agaric is quite temperamental in terms of the dose. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it also had these hallucinatory, revelatory effects upon people. In Hindu mythology, it was actually part of the great sea of milk that was churned by the moon god Chandra. And because of that, it was sort of synonymous with the nectar of the gods, Amrita, which was actually lunar light that the gods of the Hindu pantheon eat. And so it's this idea that perhaps this was some sort of entheogen that's been lost to time. Interestingly enough, there's a complete parallel with ayahuasca in terms of the lore around it, because soma was at once a beverage, a plant, and a god, just like ayahuasca. People say that the drink is the vine, is Mother Ayahuasca. It's all this one thing.
Yeah. It's definitely interesting. And another Vedic connection that I thought was really compelling was, talk to us about this, the Ayurvedic diets and how they kind of relate to the commonalities with food and entities.
Yeah, this completely blindsided me. It came at me from from out of nowhere. You know, I'm fine with Eastern philosophy, and I'm fine with, I enjoy Eastern culture here and there, but I'm not somebody that you would consider as like really into it in any sort of big way. But once I saw that there was this particular trend that was happening, it really was quite striking. And the trend is that for the most part, what people tend to receive from these entities maps on directly with a sattvic diet. Now, what a sattvic diet is it's part of Ayurvedic cuisine. In the Bhagavad Gita, they talk about three specific types of qualities that everything in existence has. They are sattva, rajas, and tamas. And rajas is the most negative. It represents lethargy and entropy. Rajas is change, action, being excited. You know, it's like a catalyst. And sattva is the purest. It's calm, it's balance, and it's order. And certain foods reflect these particular traits. So specifically in Ayurvedic cuisine, anything that is rotten or that in general is meat or is a processed food or is a canned food is tamasic. It means that it's an unpleasant sort of food. You don't want that in your body. Leftovers also fall into this category. In some traditions, eggs and garlic, peanuts, potatoes, onions, eggplants, drugs and alcohol. It's all tamasic. Mm-hmm. Then you have, you know, the next step up from that is rajasic. which are foods that you need a little bit of in order to, you know, sort of give you the reason to get up in the morning. But they're foods that inspire change and they make you too impetuous, as it were. Scaly fish, in some traditions, goat in some traditions. Also, fried foods, candies. Normally with Tamasic foods, you think of teas and coffees, spicy foods. And then Sattvic foods tend to be sweet foods, juices, honey, also dairy products, grains, nuts and seeds, and vegetables. If you look at the emphasis that is placed upon foods that people receive during these encounters, it maps almost directly onto the Sattvic diet. Now, the Sattvic diet is basically a lacto-vegetarian diet. It would be easy to say, oh, it's a lacto-vegetarian thing that people are receiving from these entities. But the interesting thing is the emphasis put on these different foods and the sort of the order that they're in maps directly onto it as well. One of the most common things that you find in fairy and alien lore, especially, is people are offered what they describe as juice drinks or fruit flavored drinks. Mm-hmm. And in the Sattvic diet, the number one Sattvic food is fruit juices. And you can just go on down the line. People are offered breads. People are offered juices. People are offered milks. People are offered vegetables. And they're not offered potatoes. They're not offered onions. They're not offered, you know, meat for the most part. So it's really interesting that it just like it really, really, really does reflect that Sattvic diet.
Yeah. And the Sattvic foods apparently are things that holy men and clairvoyants are supposed to use as well, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So this is why, you know, I sort of have come around a little bit on some of the more new age aspects of this phenomenon is because we have the same foods that people are being given in these experiences being the exact same foods that Hindu tradition says will lead to clairvoyance, will lead to a sense of inner peace. And there is a psi component, a telepathical psychic phenomena component to the abduction experience that people don't necessarily always want to acknowledge. I mean, the most famous contactee, probably Betty Hill, experienced premonitions of friends' deaths throughout her entire life. That doesn't sound to me very much like a flesh and blood alien coming down and wanting to collect her DNA and just so happening to give her telepathy or clairvoyance, rather. Or not, it's not really telepathy or clairvoyance, it's prophecy. Probably clairvoyance. I guess clairvoyance.
Psychic ability?
Yeah, psychic ability. Anyway. You don't think about entities coming down and imparting that sort of ability to her. And yet that's what she dealt with. Also, you'll find some abductees who will return from their experience and will refuse to eat meat and who will adopt something like the Sattvic diet. So, you know, that's something that once I found it seemed to be a really strong indicator that there perhaps is some sort of correlation between the two.
Yeah, I love that. And we talked about cultural overlays that might have taken fairy encounters and morphed them into alien greys in the modern times, and it's understandable how that can happen, but something that makes these stories more credible is that the food and drink in these exchanges seems to stay fairly consistent right in that wheelhouse and even across the ocean, where our Western diets are very much not the same Sattvic foods you'd expect, but yet the encounters still use foods from that category.
Yeah, and it's interesting too because, you know, it is quite consistent. The only thing that isn't that consistent is the introduction in a lot of the medical pageantry of alien abductions, this idea of taking pills or injections. I think that pills and injections can be viewed as a variation on this idea of giving someone food. It's still a substance that's administered. But the question that I have is if someone is given a pill in medieval Ireland, are they going to describe it as a pill or are they going to describe it as a wafer or a cracker or something like that?
Yeah.
This is not a book about with quantitative numbers in it because of all these vague areas, but because of little quirks like that, that you have to sort of sit back and second guess. But it's really interesting. It's really interesting to see how perhaps something that we would recognize today was misinterpreted back in medieval times.
For sure. And a good example of this kind of thing might be the Joel Simonton pancake case. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yep. Can't have this conversation without talking about good old Joe Simonton.
Of course.
Yeah. And it's one of those cases that is so famous that even if people don't know his name, you say, it's the pancake case. They're always like, oh, the pancake case. Joe Simonton, Eagle River, Wisconsin, 1961. He's cooking breakfast and he hears this strange whooshing sound outside. looks outside. He sees what look like two overturned bowls sitting in his yard, giant, with some people inside that he described as looking like dark-skinned Italians. And he sees one of them holding this shiny jug in the air, and he's like, oh, well, they must need some water. So he goes outside. He goes outside and grabs the jug, comes back in, fills it up with water, and as he's returning the jug to these, you know, Italian spacemen, he notices that one of them is cooking something on this, what he described as like this flameless griddle. So after they notice him looking at it, they actually offer him these pancakes. He's given several of them. He's actually given four of them. And, you know, the aliens wave goodbye and they depart. So this should be great. This should be really exciting because we have actual food from one of these encounters. This should be important. And, you know, he takes one and he gives it to a local judge. He takes one and gives it to J. Allen Hynek, who I believe at the time was still attached to Project Blue Book with the Air Force. He gives one to NICAP, a National Investigation Committee on Aerial Phenomena. And he kept one for himself. And it was claimed that they were all made up of mundane ingredients, barley and wheat and just earthly grain. Which is super disappointing because, you know, you'd hope that there would be some sort of exotic strain or at least something that, you know, hadn't been on Earth in a while or something interesting like that. But what is interesting that I think is something that you can take away from this is that he said that they tasted awful, almost tasteless, which again mirrors this idea that fairy food is something that is cloaked to appear more appealing than it is. Yeah. And, you know, he ate it and it didn't taste like anything, which seems to map onto that. But also really interesting is that there is some European folklore that a specific type of fairy who lived on the Friesland Islands would actually help farmers in the field by giving them fresh water and pancakes. Mm. So it's a nice little connection there.
Right. And how is he supposed to know that? And that's
exactly.
Apparently one of these pancakes might have ended up in a museum.
Yeah, I've heard that. I think it was I think Tim Beckley mentioned that there's a rumor that in a glass display case at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in the cafeteria, there's one of Joe Simonton's pancakes. I don't know. I hadn't found anything about that specifically, but I absolutely love that idea. It's hilarious.
Yeah, man, this is all really fascinating stuff. And I also really enjoy the work of David Politis. I know he comes up a lot in your conversations. He's got to, and everybody's in this realm these days, but, I wonder if some of these missing people he talks about might be the ones who ate the food and never came back.
Yeah, it's compelling. I mean, it's you know, I think that well, with the danger of sounding like I want to glom onto his work because everybody I think wants to do that now he's become so popular.
Yeah.
David is doing some great work and is really doing something that I think is important work, and it's interesting to see how there's the small similarity that runs through some of his work of people going to pick berry bushes. And some of the ones who come back recall, you know, being near a berry bush or going off to pick berries or something, which I think might have something to do with this. You know, I always joke, he's ruled out that it's not Sasquatch, but I'm like, no, it's got to be fairies. Maybe it's fairies. But yeah, it's interesting. I think that there's perhaps a little tangential connection there.
Right on. Man, well, the rabbit hole does run deep, but I really had a great time. I think that the book is a great addition to my weird collection, and it's a unique take on something that can sometimes be oversaturated with those simple, same old stories. So great job on Trojan Feast. And just before we go, tell people where, if you have a website or where they can keep up on what you're doing and where they can get these books.
I would love to. My website is joshuacutchin.com, JOSHUACUTCHIN. I blog as often as I can on there. I think the latest blog is talking about how Deadpool is our first true trickster protagonist
love
on screen.
It. I like that movie.
Yeah, I did too. And it's interesting because, you know, everybody wants to call Deadpool an anti-hero, but he really is literally, I think he's the first example of the first main character in a film that has been a trickster, because straight up he is a trickster. So I tried to sort of break that down. So yeah, some blogs and some stuff popping up there every now and then. But in terms of where you can find a Trojan Feast, you can find it at Amazon or Barnes & Noble, and there are links on the front page to click through to those.
Boom. Well, thanks again, man. Loved it, and keep doing what you're doing out there.
Hey, I really appreciate it. Thanks so much for having me on. This has been a great talk.
You got it, man. Boom, people. Joshua Cutchin and a Trojan Feast, following up soon with a book about strange smells in these types of encounters. And I just love bringing on a guest once in a while that's tackled these kinds of things and can just relay good, creepy encounter stories. Of course, some people will inevitably say to me, with everything going on in the world, don't you think there's more important things to cover? And, well, the world is always on the apparent brink of chaos, and you can't get sucked into that too much or you'll have a very anxious life. Besides, when you examine threads like these, you might actually get close to some hidden truths in there. When commonalities stretch across the ocean and across time, you have to wonder if there isn't some underlying truth to what's going on, and if fairies and aliens and the entheogenic experience are connected in some way. I see that as a big deal. When you consider that a lot of the fairy lore comes from the UK and Ireland, and like Mike Mott pointed out, how fitting that most of these tales involve a sexual or genetic component. If you were going to carry out some kind of early monitoring or genetic farming campaign, you'd start on an island, a place you could control. Of course, now it's more of a widespread thing, but that's going to happen. Humans are more widespread than ever. And of course, how interesting that a large concentration of these stories in the old days also come from the areas of the largest reigning monarchs and elite European bloodlines. Of course, correlation isn't causation and all that good stuff. But if this phenomenon has anything to do with the elite or factors into the actions of the elite, assuming they know more about it than we do, that's probably even more important than some of the latest drama with Russia. Who knows, tomorrow I might feel differently, but a lot of listeners have been requesting some Sasquatch topics, and I thought it was a good way to touch on that and also dive deeper into the alien fairy connection and what might be multidimensional or subterranean mystical beings we share the planet with in some capacity. That is more interesting to me than Sasquatch, but it ain't all about me. I aim to please. I mean, that Sadvik diet connection is almost as interesting as the Rh negative stuff to me. It's also great to connect entheogens to this realm where some researchers don't bring it up at all. But big thanks to Joshua for making it happen and quitting that day job. You know, if you have any practical skill like teaching music, you don't need to work for a school or a hierarchical structure anymore. The reason people did have to do that is because the school brought in students. But you don't need that middleman anymore. You can reach the students directly. You could reach people who want to learn directly. And it's a beautiful thing to see more and more people realizing that and just walking away from that old system. Because that middleman never breaks you off what you're truly worth. And you realize that when you make that direct connection. I think it was Kevin Kelly who first brought up the idea of 1,000 true fans is all you really need. Or you could think of that as customers or clients. If you can connect to them yourself, you can be yourself and your own boss. And I think that is the thing that can really save our system. I mean, I wish we could rebuild the whole thing, but that doesn't seem likely in my lifetime. So remember that every dollar you spend on an independent person is $1 weaker for the corporatocracy. That might be the best we get. But this is just how technological progress is working itself out. It happens in stages. First, you know, a lot of people are realizing they don't need a home phone anymore. And then some are graduating to cord cutting. You don't need cable when you have Netflix or Hulu or BitTorrent. But those aren't scary things to leave behind. It's the job. That's the big one. But what a tangent that was. So pulling it back in, the first hour was fun. You know, the second hour is no different. We get into the foison concept where entities take only the essence rather than the actual food. And that opens the door into offerings to entities and feeding off of fear and how that might tie into the fear campaign of the elite or entities who try to tend to scare us first or kids who are found tired or unconscious after going missing in the woods. There might be something to that energy drain, feeding on emotion type of thing. We also talk about habitualizing Sasquatch, sleep paralysis, and then a bit about Josh's work examining the trickster element in classical music. And that's a bit of a departure, but we've seen music tie into so many other things like math and science and possibly levitation technology that you have to kind of talk about that to someone who is a bit of an expert and see if they might have some of those more fringe ideas. So think about signing up. You've probably been listening to the show for a long time. $5 couldn't really be much cheaper, and you'll be doubly entertained. And the iPhone app looks like it's about done. We're just dealing with Apple's ridiculous certification process and all that good stuff, but it should be here soon. Of course, the Plus forums are becoming quite popular. I'm having a hell of a time trying to keep up. And I know the guest request thread is really backed up, but I have so many on my list already. And that's the thing. I get about a dozen guest requests a day through Facebook, Twitter, email, even Reddit. Even the Higher Side Chat subreddit is getting some lately. And I definitely bookmark all of them, but I have to look to the Plus people first for that because they're basically, really, the executive producers of the show. Also, I get a ton of messages about where to get the music I use for the end of the show. Again, free downloads on the Plus site because the Plus members pay for it. So become one and reap the benefits. There's also a special direct messaging system where you can reach me a bit more easily than email or Facebook. And I also try to respond to anyone who posts in the introduction form. I think I'm at 100% right now. But you know how it works. You've heard it before, so I'll just leave it at that. The world is a weird place. Find your weird place in it. Again, Trojan Feast, really interesting book and subject. And I gotta declare this edition of the Midnight Society closed. Your move, entities of the other world, and your odd consumable offerings. Your fucking move.
Oh no. You see, the world isn't random, it's attached to puppet strings. Control over everything. The 9 to 5 is trying to steal ya. Now don't that job seem silly? Hello, can you hear me? Or should I play back? From some spike agency. Wish we were younger and free. I'll be thankful when it's all exposed. The vast conspiracy. There's such a difference between us and the damn world.
Thank you. we can't.